We are running a little bit behind, but that's understandable. We had a Bible study from a representative from the missions out in St. Louis. Shane Smithson was here. Not really Shane, can you make it over here? So we're running a little bit late, but that's okay. And we are very blessed and humbled to have with us the president of the LCMS Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, Reverend Dr. Matthew Harrison, who is getting his vestments on as we speak. And he will be bringing us a message from the Lord's Word today. A very powerful word that is very edifying for those who are here. So welcome to all who are here in the sanctuary. Welcome to all who are tuning in at home. Just one announcement. We do have a meeting this evening over at East Central, I believe, for the upcoming National Youth Gathering. And that is from 5 to 7. I believe pizza is going to be provided. But also that is the time that the $200 deposit is going to be due, and I was told that if we have trouble with that, please come anyway. We will make that happen. So, with that, we are here to worship the Lord. So, I'd like you all to stand and we sing our opening. Receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of and dissolve. Let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner.
Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us our sins and lead us to everlasting life. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose strength is made perfect in weakness, grant us humility and childlike faith, that we may please you in both will and deed. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Old Testament reading for this morning is from Jeremiah chapter 11. The Lord made it known to me, and I knew it. Then you showed me their deeds, but I was like a gentle lamb led into the slaughter. I did not know it was against me. They devised schemes, saying, let us destroy the tree with its fruit. Let us cut him off from the land of the living, that his name be remembered no more. But you, O Lord of hosts, who judges righteously, who tests the heart and the mind, let me see your vengeance upon them. For to you have I committed my cause. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading is from James chapter 3 and 4. Who is wise and understanding among you? By his good conduct, let him show his works in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast and be false to the truth. This is not the wisdom that comes down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be disorder in every vile practice. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. And the harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. What causes quarrels and what causes fights among you? Is it not this, that your passions are at war within you? This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
If anyone would be first, must be master of all and servant of all. He took a child and put him in the midst of them, and taking him in his arms, he said to them, whoever receives one such child in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you. not give my whole sort of educated life. I know I found out that the old college burnt down right here. What an amazing thing to see the spot and to see the campus and to know the connections and to know how Lenore Ryan started off Concordia and how Concordia Church was founded. What famous names were here over all those years. To see the parts and pieces from the old church put right here in the chapel in this magnificent building, this award-winning building which I had never visited before. Fantastic. Thank you. And I know you treasure that blessed past. It is something to be treasured. It's a gift of God. And you may see a halo around my head this morning. You see it? Well, maybe not. I don't know. I'm a first-grade, second-grade banjo player. And for as long as I've been playing banjo, the better part of 50 years, I've wanted to go down to Shelby and see where Earl Scruggs came from. So we went down there yesterday and got to see the old shack off in the sticks where Earl was a child. So that was a real, real delight I shall not soon forget. It's great to be a first-grade, second-grade banjo player. Well, this is a difficult topic today, really. Jesus said, look, guys, I'm going to Jerusalem. I'm going to be handed over, and they're going to kill me. On the third day, I'm going to rise again. And every time Jesus says this in the Gospels, they don't get it. And it's amazing. You know, he speaks it very plainly. Just before this, he was talking to Simon Peter and to all the disciples. And he said, who do men say that I am? And they answered, some say you're John the Baptist, some say Elijah the prophet, some say this or that. And Jesus said, but you, who do you say that I am? The question that hits every one of us right between the eyes right now. Who do you say that I am? What did Peter respond? But thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus praised him. Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, because flesh and blood has not revealed this to you. And then what does Jesus say? He says, the Son of Man must be handed over, suffer, die, and on the third day rise again. What does Peter say? No, Lord, it can never happen. And then Jesus gives the strongest rebuke in the entire New Testament. And mind you, he gives it to the chief of the apostles. Get thee behind me,
Satan.
Oh, you've read it before. That's a good sign, Pastor. The strongest rebuke is to Peter. Get behind me, Satan. Imagine that. Well, what's the problem? You see, Peter was denying the very means by which God promised to redeem the world. Through suffering, death, extraordinary. But you know what? That's the way the Lord desires to work. You know, there's a strange thing in Mark's gospel. The demons know who Jesus is. John the Baptizer knows. God knows. Look, this is my son. Love the son. Listen to him. But nobody else gets him right. The apostles don't like the suffering part. They don't get it. Other people don't get it. You know who finally, of all sort of non-spiritual God or demons, you know who finally gets Jesus right in the gospel? Jesus in chapter 15 is hanging dead on a cross. And there's a centurion next to him. And the centurion says, truly, this man was the Son of God. Revealed in death. Now, if you were there, say you were one of the apostles or one of the women, the apostles fled. Say the women are watching from far off, seeing Jesus crucified. They see him hanging dead on the cross. What would you think? This is terrible. This is the worst thing that could possibly happen. This cannot be happening. He was everything we were hoping in. He can't. can't be the Messiah. We don't believe in a dead Messiah. God must have hated him. God must have hated us. Everything we believed over the last 3 years is false. You think they were thinking that? They certainly were. And yet, what was going on? The greatest divine act in the history of the universe. For will. God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. He was put to death for our transgressions and raised for our justification. Praise the Lord. We preach Christ the crucified. After he rose from the grave, Thomas said, I'm not going to believe till I put my fingers in the very holes. And Jesus, with his resurrected body, gave him that very body. The same body that had died had risen. And that death is for all sin. Yes, every sin. Every single sin, all sins, every sinner, everywhere. Luther was asked one time, don't you wish, John 3:16 said, for God so loved Martin Luther? And Luther said, no, that would be terrible. Then I'd be wondering if there's another guy out there somewhere named Martin Luther. It says, for God so loved the world. Is there anybody excluded? The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all our sins. All the sins of the world have been paid for. How do we take advantage of it? Through repentance and faith. And you need it, every one of you. You know, today's epistle, James, mentions a lot of sins. Demonic, he calls them. Sins. Dissension. And there are sins of lust, and sins of greed, and anger, and sins of jealousy, and stinginess, and who knows what else. You've got all kinds of sins that plague every single one of us. Be honest, will you? I know you liked it when he talked about murder, because you could at least say to that one, I'm not in that category anywhere. But guess what? Jesus says he who hates his brother is a murderer. Have you ever hated somebody? I have. You may have hated a pastor of this church. You may have hated a certain member of this church. You may have hated people in your own family. Jesus says he who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Who of us does that not condemn? Stand up and shout, yay, I'm not a sinner. Like Luther said about such people, we'll put some big donkey ears on you and bells around your neck and we'll worship you. The fact is, no one is righteous. No, not one. All have sinned and fall short. Every one of us, words, grand sin against the first commandment, anxiety. Don't you believe God will take care of you? Hasn't he said to you, pray this way. My Father is now your Father, our Father who art in heaven. Don't you know? Look at the lilies of the field. They're here today, gone tomorrow, thrown into the fire. Aren't you? And they're so beautiful. Don't you know that you are a billion times more valuable than any flower? Look at the birds of the air, doesn't God? They don't work or do anything, but God takes care of them. Don't you think you're more valuable than they are? Won't he take care of you? And yet you worry about this. You worry about your health. You worry about your children. You worry about your grandchildren. You worry about whether you have enough money. You worry about whether. And the truth is, tell me if this is not true. 99% of what you worry about never takes place. Does it? That's certainly true with me, okay? Wretches, everyone. Because you know how much better. might enjoy the furniture in here, the award-winning building, the nice, beautiful new floor. You might like the pastor personality, who knows what. But you're missing the main thing. Christ is for sinners. Come to me, all you weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Jesus says, I came not for the righteous, but for sinners. You'd better be one. And I tell you today, right now, and it happens this moment, your sins are forgiven by Jesus. Your secret sins, your troubling sins, those sins that were committed years ago, the sins you committed in anger against somebody who sinned against you, the sins between you and your spouse, the sins that have broken your family, the sins that trouble your conscience. I tell you, your sins are forgiven now. You know, a lot of people think church is where you go to praise the Lord and give him some stuff, throw in some money, and then you go home and you work your rest of your week giving things to your neighbors, serving there, or your family, or whatever. It's not quite that way. I just stole this from Luther, and I use it all the time, but it's really a good thing to remember. When you come into church, you say, dear God, I got an empty sack. I, a poor, miserable sinner, we confess, don't we? Dear God, I got an empty sack. And the pastor says, in the stead by the command of Christ, I forgive you. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, this is the interactive part of the sermon, so get ready. And after he says that absolution, what do you say? What?
Amen.
You will not make good Southern Baptists, I tell you. That's a good thing overall, but this is good. You say, Amen. It's in the Bible. And then you hear the lessons read. And the gospel comes to you in the lessons, and you say, Amen. I got the, that's in the Bible. Grace and mercy, word of God, peace. Then the sermon is preached. And the pastor, yeah, he tells you you're a sinner under the law, but you are forgiven. Christ came only for sinners, and that is yours right now as it's spoken. The gospel is the power of God in salvation. Luther says God's words and his acts are the same thing. So God's word says this, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I tell you, the word of God is spoken to you now. Believe it! And even as I say believe it, that word causes you to believe. What do you say after the sermon?
Amen.
Amen. It's in the bag. I got a big load of that forgiveness. I'll tell you what. Grace, mercy, and peace. Then you come up here to the sacrament. You kneel, and the pastor says, take and eat, body and blood, give and shed for you for the
forgiveness.
And then you say?
Amen.
Amen. It's in the bag. Got it right there. And at the end of the service, the pastor will say, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. And many times in the liturgy at that point, we say Amen three times over. Amen, Amen, Amen. I really got it. It's in the bag. I got it tied up. It's over my shoulder. Praise the Lord. I'm out of here. And then on the way home, your spouse sins against you. What do you do? You grab that bag and you go, wham! God, oh Lord, forgiveness, grace, and mercy. I can't open that bag up and give it to you. And your kids drive you nuts and sin against you. I forgive you. And you sin against your kids because you responded harshly. And you use that forgiveness for yourself in order to encourage you to say, yeah, kids, I overdid it. Would you forgive me, please? And that neighbor grabs you. And the people of work, and you need forgiveness, life, and mercy, and you need something to help you be strong enough so you can be charitable and kind to somebody. Give them a few bucks without thinking it's going to kill you. I've been blessed. I can't forgive you. I've been blessed. And next week you come back to church and you say, well, dear God, I got it. You know, you said. And don't make the mistake of thinking church is not significant. You have the most significant force for a joyful, reconciled family life here. Because it happens this way. You sin against your spouse, or you're in a spat about something on the way to church even. I used to have that problem in my life. And what would we say? Oh, we got a problem here. We sure got a problem. And it's you. And finally, we go to church. Might have even been arguing about something serious for a few days. Go to church. Finally, I know my wife knows exactly what she's confessing. And she knows exactly what I'm confessing. We have been confessing for several days, oh dear Lord, you're her poor miserable sinner. I'm going to meet the church and say, I hear her say, do you hear me? Speak this forgiveness in your families, my friends. We often fail to do it. Speak to your children. And parents, don't get confused. If I forgive them, that means they're not being held accountable. No, no, no. You're confusing the two kingdoms. You're a parent. Okay, Jimmy, you got in trouble. You're grounded for a week. No car. That's just the way it's got to be. But I want you to know this is more important. Jesus named your sins. You're one. You're forgiven by Jesus. To speak it, please. It's the most powerful thing in your family. And you know what? It's as effective as if it was spoken by the mouth of your pastor. It's as effective when you speak the word of God as if Jesus spoke it himself. The word of God is the power of God in salvation. Now, Jesus works his good stuff through crosses and delivers it through the stuff I just told you. Speaking of the word, receiving his gifts in church, taking that gift outside. And he drives us to that often by the way he continues to work. He works through crosses in this life. We face many crosses and trials in this life, don't we? Many things that are inexplicable. This life is not all joy and victory. And at the end, barring Christ's return, we're going to die. I've seen a lot of people die as a pastor. It's not pleasant. But you know what? Those trials and difficulties chase us to Jesus. Those trials and difficulties work steadfastness, repentance, faith, constance, hope, love. They drive us to Jesus, and they drive us to one another in love. My dear friends, that's how it happens that we are last. I don't want to be anyplace else but on Jesus' lap. I want to be a little child on Jesus' lap. I want only Jesus. Give me Jesus, my Savior, my crucified and risen Lord. He is the most. I'm the least. Only give me Jesus. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Together we confess.
Father, before all worlds, God of God, judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For humility, the God who opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble, would help us to submit to him and resist the devil, that the devil would flee from us. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our sinners, leaders, for all pastors, that the Lord would give them wisdom that comes from above, that he would make them peaceful, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good works, impartial and sincere, and that they would sow among us in peace, yielding a harvest of righteousness. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the Holy Spirit would pacify our passions, and that we would not be ruled by the jealousy and selfish ambition that give rise to disorder and every vile practice. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the Lord would uphold this world in his work, for the church, that she would be defended from all enemies, for our homes, that the Lord would bless parents and children in loving, forgiving service toward each other, and for the government, that God would grant all authorities health and godly wisdom. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the sick among us, those who are in need, for the injured, the recovering, those who are facing surgery, those who struggle with anxiety, depression, addictions, that God would grant them healing, release, comfort, and peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who come to the altar this day, that in repentance with cleansed hands and purified hearts, we may receive Christ, who draws near to us in his body and blood, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Lord of hosts, grant that what we ask from you may not be squandered after our passions, but sought rightly in faith, that we may receive them and put them to service for you and for our neighbors. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, the Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created, and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-man sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, for the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all faith the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying to him, "This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And in the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink it all. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and lead us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
thanks you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the Sabbath. We implore you that of your mercy and strengthen us through the same. In faith toward you and in perfect love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
God bless you and keep you. The Lord may his face.